Thank you very much. And welcome to Cats and Dogs here on Press TV with me, Len Potopic. And today is all about talk of taming the Asian dragon. Let's start with a review of a theatrical performance a few weeks ago in Cornwall, in England's rugged southwestern tip. The show had seven actors, and we expected to watch something like The Seven Samurai, but it turned out to be a comedy show instead. It might be called Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. The Europeans and the Americans were fighting like cats and dogs. See what I did there? Up to a few months ago when Trump was still in office. But suddenly, they all woke up, except for Joe Biden, of course, and realized that they had to stand together in the face of the Asian dragon. G7, or in plain English, the Gangs of New York, are six countries under the command of Uncle Sam in their battle against China. The group was supposed to promote unity among the world's industrial powers, but it soon became a kind of parody of Don Quixote. That's the romantic and deranged Spanish knight. Except that, unlike Don Quixote, this motley crew is fighting three different enemies, namely China, China, and China. In one of their latest schemes, the United States and its soldiers decided to confront China's One Belt, One Road. But given budget deficits and other technical problems, which Mrs. Merkel correctly confessed to, they ended up with the idea of one road, one robber, which is more honest and a lot cheaper. And let's face it, they have to collect enough money before initiating any project of that level. The G7 members have called their plan to confront the growing influence of China CGI, or Clean Green Initiative. But I think it meaningfully stands for Computer Graphic and Imagery, which again in plain English means the fantasy role-play game, also known as Fighting and Defeating China. For now, the G7 has put the Clean Green Initiative option on the table. It is interesting that the US and its European allies are so interested in the color green, especially when confronting the Chinese. When they were producing all that coal, their favorite color was black. And then when they went all industrial, they ran a wide spectrum of colors, but it was mainly shiny and metallic and silver. Now that China has gained momentum as the factory of the world, they say everyone should love and respect green. They're all in love with nature and trees and pastures and vales and dales and romantic poems and dogs and meadows and that soft focus kind of thing that you see in toilet roll commercials. The point is that they've not made it at all clear how they can afford the Clean Green Initiative or how and when it will even be operational. We also saw Biden and the British monarch drink their cups of tea and share their special relationship, with Joe no doubt sharing his fond memories of the time that he left England on that ship with the Pilgrim Fathers. And then the US president read out a one-line statement in which he mixed up Syria with Libya.
We could work together with Russia, for example, in Libya. We should be opening up the passes to be able to go through and provide food assistance and economic assistance.
Don't beat yourself up about it, Joe. I know it must be very difficult to differentiate between places you've already razed to the ground, whether it is Syria or Libya or Afghanistan or Iraq or Vietnam. Actually, that last one was a long time ago, don't worry. In fact, don't worry at all. Be happy. At least you've not mixed up China and Canada. At least not yet. While it's true that over the past decades, the Chinese have been building bridges around the globe using trillions of dollars worth of investments, that's not the only thing bothering these world leaders. Taming the Asian dragon was just one of the aims of the not-so-magnificent seven. Another ambition was to vaccinate the world against the coronavirus. But then our favourite phenomenon here at Cats and Dogs, namely irony, reared its head when the entire Indian delegation in the UK for the G7 talks had to self-isolate after 2 COVID cases were detected. They came to help the G7 fight the Chinese, but in the end, they had to stay at their hotel rooms, wash their hands constantly, keep social distancing, and eat lots of duck soup. So while the Chinese have managed to sell something like 68 mega projects to the Africans, I think the Europeans have managed to vaccinate something like 68 people on the whole of the African continent. Many like to describe the new confrontation between the American camp and China as Cold War 2.0, but I think it's more proper if you describe it as Crazy War 1000. Unlike the USSR, China is the linchpin of the world economy and dominates the global supply chain. And the country's domination of these critical arteries has also proved immune to global shocks. Even Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau said that the G7 should have influence in the world just like China and build infrastructures just like the Chinese have built. The fact is that many of these nations don't want to or don't dare to antagonize China. French President Emmanuel Macron, who was recently slapped by a French medieval sword enthusiast, making him a kind of modern-day Don Quixote, I suppose. Well, the French president doesn't seem to want to get another much bigger slap, this time by the Asian giant. He says he considers joining an anti-China bloc as an erosion of strategic autonomy. And then there's the German chancellor, who's spending her last months in office. And she was instrumental in arranging the EU-China comprehensive agreement on investment. That was a big deal. And it seems that she prefers to sell more Volkswagens, Daimlers and BMWs than supporting bungling Biden's blunders. I'm pretty sure the highly experienced and wily British monarch has realised the danger of fighting China. She knows that the Chinese crocodile that used to play in the pond is now flying high, like a dragon that doesn't respond well to provocation.
Come on, boy. Come on.
You know, the G7 talks were more like family chats than anything else. At the end of the talks, Biden summed up that
she,
that's the Queen,
reminded me of my mother.
I mean, leaving aside the strangeness of that comment, I imagine that, given Biden's own age, old Joe's even older mum was probably old enough to be everybody's mother. After all, Biden on his own raised the average age of the G7 participants by about 200 years. The fitting irony is that the Chinese have so far asked the G7 members to stop all this negativity towards them because that might set a bad example for the younger generation. Last but not least, in the final communique released by the G7, they called on Beijing to respect human rights and nature. So let's get this straight. America, France, and the UK are telling China to respect human rights and nature. So basically, again in plain English, these self-righteous preachers are telling the Chinese to stop trying to do what the G7 countries were doing for centuries, because this planet ain't big enough for the 8 of us. I think they might want to check the label on just about any major item they need, they want, they buy or wear. I think you'll find it says, made in China. Except when it comes to invading the Middle East, of course. That kind of madness always tends to say, made in America. That's it for this time. Join me again to find out if anyone does succeed in taming that Asian dragon, whether any nation is crazy enough to try to invade it, and if any item of clothing worn by the G7 was not made in China. That's all with me, Lembit Opik, on Press TV and Cats and Dogs.